Richard's contract story time. So we're gonna go over some parts of my contract that I included or already was in there that either saved my butt because of a customer, you know, preventing customer issues, all that good stuff. So let's get right into it. We're not gonna do any kind of intro or anything. I think I probably put it at the beginning of this video. So let's get right into it. We're just gonna go through a couple spots. Something, you know, a little bit of story time here. So main one, change orders. Contractor will perform all of these services approved in the writing with the homeowner. If the homeowner shall at any time require services not listed in the scope of work attached to this contract, a written change order shall be created and signed by both parties. Prior to the performance of any change order, full payment for additional work will be required. So that's verbatim. Why? Because a couple things. Customers, you know, they get the I wants, and then, you know, they see like an open concept where you're tearing stuff down, and then they change their mind, no problem. If you already have a certain fee for square footage for a certain tile, for, you know, drywall, all this kind of stuff, you know, they have the walls done, now they want the ceiling done, it adds time, and obviously it takes time out of your day to get additional materials, all that kind of stuff. It all has to be paid for, and it extends out the job. So sign, everything's been writing, sign change order, even if it's less work, it's just change order, less work, credit, all that good stuff. So yeah, make sure you have a change order for sure. All right. On another one would be plans and permit fee. I do a permit fee and a plans and permit fee because I have to, you know, the township's always going to want a drawing of whatever you're building out there, decks, additions, load bearing supports, all that kind of stuff. So in my contract, I have a plans and permit fee, and that is non-refundable. So once I collect a deposit, I'm drawing out the plans, and I have to pay for my time. Those are not refundable. So I had a customer who wanted, they just wanted to consolidate. They didn't know where they were, and as far as the contract was concerned, so we had to sit down and go through. And then they saw my plans and permit fee, and they're wondering why it was so high as opposed to the permit fee itself. And I explained to them, because I had to draw your entire job site, 3 or 4 trips to the township because they wanted other BS, and you're paying for my time. So that's basically how it goes. Let's go to the next page. This is about, I think, a 12-page contract. So it's pretty basic, nothing crazy. Homeowner is responsible for the security of all pets on the job site at all times. That's it. There's nothing else to be said. If a cat runs out the door, dog runs out, we have to keep the door open for production to, you know, get long materials inside the house. So it is what it is. It says right in the contract, we're not responsible for any pets at any time. If they sit behind a truck and we run it over, we're not responsible because it's in the contract. So yeah, it would suck, but at the same time, it's in the contract, so it's not our liability. Let's see here. All right, acts of God. This was obviously put in. I put this in last year because of COVID. So contractor and homeowner are not responsible for any acts of God in any way if outside governing bodies impose work-related restrictions or work stoppages, but both contractor and homeowner will abide by such restrictions until such restrictions are lifted by the governing bodies. If either the contractor or homeowner feel unsafe by any acts of God, both parties may suspend work with written notice to the other party. Work will resume once both the homeowner and contractor agree to resume work. So that happened once, well, happened twice where customers got COVID. So this video is probably gonna get demonetized now that I said COVID. So anyways, but, and then they say, hey, you know, the 10 to 14, you know, period, we just basically, hey, we'll stay off site. You know, you just let us know when you guys have negative tests and you're good to go. And that was it. So, and really, I didn't require written writing because they texted me. So technically that's in writing and when it was emailed me. So it is what it is. That's pretty much, now that can be not just that, it could be anything else. If a customer has a crazy low immune system for any reason, hey, they don't want anybody inside their house, all that kind of stuff, but it's in the contract. So we can abide by it. And if we feel unsafe because the customer wants us to be there, even though they're, you know, obviously have a disease or something like that we don't want to catch, then we can just say, hey, well, you know, we'll be back in a week or two and you feel better. So, all right, next one. Any unknown conditions are the responsibility of the homeowner to correct. Contractor is not responsible if any existing, we don't need to worry about that. So any unknown conditions are the responsibility of the homeowner to correct. Basically, if we're doing something and there's a gas line buried or a water line buried and we need to get to that location, we're not responsible for relocating that gas line or water line. happened multiple times. Anything unknown, you know, hey, even my estimates say, hey, you know, estimate based off visual inspection, you know, unknown, unforeseen circumstances will result in a change order. So, you know, you have to protect yourself. You never know what you're doing on a remodel and anything really, because there's crap that we're doing a deck right now, and then there was like poured like 4-foot slab underneath about 3 foot of dirt. So, I mean, come on, how are you gonna find that out, right? So, that's another good one. It saved my butt a couple times, or almost every time, really, because you know customers don't want to pay for anything they didn't know about either. So, homeowner agrees to that any unforeseen complications may increase the final price of the project. So that falls basically under the same as unforeseen circumstances and complications. So say if I'm trying to think of an example for this. If they want to, we say if we're, you know, we're digging up holes and there's something underneath it. I'm trying to think. This is basically the same thing, but it's worded a little different for the reason itself. If there's nothing you've seen, or it's not your responsibility as a contractor, basically. So it's the homeowner's property, and you basically have to deal with it. I mean, there is, they can not pay for it, and we can, you know, cover it up and go someplace else with it, or they can pay us to relocate whatever we're trying to do, and we keep the job site moving. So that's basically what that seems. All right. Any changes requested to the job site that will not affect the final product outcome is subject to the contractor approval and a change order. So that is for your OCD customer that, you know, you're painting and you're doing certain things, and then they're like, hey, instead of, you know, painting, you already got to paint it, and instead of painting it this way, they want you to paint it the opposite way. It's not going to affect the outcome of the, you know, it's, this is what you bid, and then they tell you after the fact, change order, because you got to basically repaint it, go in the stripe at the same, you know, roll it the same way you know they want it, or, you know, anything basically. If they, hey, this, you know, this light, even though it's perfectly centered on a wall, and they want to change, they want to push it like 4 inches over because of their OCD, you know, stuff like that. So, yeah, the change order, we can do it, move it over, repair the driveway, all that kind of stuff. So it protects us from the OCD customer nitpicking stuff, and it's in the contract. So after that, we've got payment schedules. So if you need to have payment, depending on the job you're doing, payment schedules are absolutely a must, because you got to dictate when you're getting paid. So, right. All right. Anything else under here? Oh, punch list. Like, this is under final inspection, but punch list will be approved by the contractor and homeowner. So I've had a couple punch lists where customers are like, oh, fix this. And it wasn't even a wall that we actually even did work on. So I was like, no, we're not fixing that, because we didn't even do any of this over here. Like, this is not our work. So, you know, that over here, no problem. We get this little spot here, a little hair that got painted into the wall. We'll fix that, no big deal. But over here, not our problem. We didn't paint it. We didn't do anything over here. We didn't fix anything on this side of the house. So guess what? We're not doing it. So, save me too. All right. So under warranty, in the state of Michigan, we are in the state of Michigan, 18-month warranty. If some customers request a higher warranty, you can feel free to give it to if you want to, or whatever is mandated by your state, but charge more for it, because, you know, that means you're on the hook for longer to go out and fix stuff that customers, either something happened. But, I mean, I've gone out past 18 months to fix stuff because it was obviously manufacturer defect, or, you know, something that we missed back in the day that they didn't find out. So, but 18-month warranty. I think that's about it on this, you guys. Like, I think I'm going through here. None of this is legal advice. I'm going to tell you that right now. I'm not a lawyer. This is not legal advice. I'm just trying to share some stuff through my contract that basically might help you guys out. Make sure if you're licensed, make sure your contract has your license number on it and all your information, because it's obviously a legally binding document. And make it as detailed as possible. Scope of work is, like, I'll spend most of the time on scope of work, because you want to make sure that you're in the loop. The customer knows exactly what to expect for scope of work. And I reference my estimate, because my estimate has a pretty good amount of detail on it too. So I'll attach the estimate to this. Hey, reference the estimate. And then also what's in here, I didn't highlight here. Two more things. Homeowner agrees to maintain adequate property insurance. So that's required. I think my insurance requires that from the actual homeowner. So they got to have their own property insurance in case something happens. So, because, you know, dispute, if they cause an accident and they try to blame it on you kind of thing. So, and then, all right, guys, that's basically all I have today. Like and subscribe. I'll see you in the next video. I appreciate it. We'll get the new contract sometime from my my law firm, and then we'll have it on Patreon page. Appreciate y'all's support up there as well. And